Hello everyone, welcome to my channel. I am Zach Peterson. I'm here to answer all your questions about PCB design. And today we're gonna be looking at a viewer question on one of my most recent office hours videos. This question relates to vias on high speed lines, specifically stitching vias and signal vias and how they should be designed and placed in a PCB layout. We're gonna take a look at some examples in Simbeor in this video. So let's go ahead and get started. So before we get started doing some calculations with some vias on high-speed lines, let's take a look at that viewer question. Ducal192 writes, "Hi Zachariah, in this via at 5 minutes, you talk about vias on high-speed signals. Would you recommend keeping the same amount of vias on a differential pair, and also even if they are routed single-ended? What about the other pairs? Would it be better to give them all the same amount of vias even if it is not necessary for routing?" So this question is in reference to one of our office hours videos, and in that video, I am answering questions about PCB design from my Altium Academy videos. Now, of course, one thing that often comes up in this context, which was specifically about stackups, was whether or not you should put stitching vias near signal vias that are carrying high-speed signals. The answer is yes, you should, and there are several reasons for doing this. Reason number one is that it defines the return path for the signal that's transitioning through the PCB stackup. And we need to do that so we can control EMI. Essentially, it reduces EMI generation from that signal. It also impacts susceptibility to EMI. The other reason that we do that is that for single-ended signals, as we'll see once we start doing some simulations, those stitching vias near the signal via define the impedance of that via. Now, the antipad in the plane where the signal passes through, that also defines the impedance of the via. So the two really have an interplay together. Now, on differential pairs, it's not strictly required that you place the stitching vias around your signal vias, but there are reasons to use them. The first is that it does impact EMI and susceptibility, but it's not really required to generate the return current because, as you remember from some of our other videos, that the signals in a differential pair are self-referential. Basically, each trace or each via forms the reference for the other trace or via. The other reason we do it is because the placement of those stitching vias does define the TEM mode cutoff when we start dealing with interfaces that require very high bandwidth channels. So this is when you start getting into the 25 gigahertz or 50 gigahertz range. Very high bandwidth channels. There's a third reason that we might need to do it, and that reason is because when we have a very large antipad opening around a differential pair, then the stitching vias start to define the impedance rather than the antipad. So if the stitching vias are closer than the antipad, those dominate defining the impedance, and vice versa. If the antipad is closer, it dominates defining the impedance. The fourth one is related to the second reason, and this fourth reason has to do with confining the field around the differential pair. And this is something called localization, and it's actually something we can see directly inside of Simbeor. So I think that's the perfect segue as far as what we're gonna do in this video. What we're gonna do is hop into Simbeor, and we're gonna take a look at what happens when we start adding stitching vias to signal vias that are carrying high-speed signals. So the board we're gonna be looking at that I have up here inside of Simbeor is an FPGA data capture board. And basically, it is an FPGA with some memory, a lot of power regulators, and then you can see here we have signals breaking out to several connectors. So this FPGA has multiple differential pairs on it, obviously. And if we take a look at some of these layers, we can identify some of the differential pairs. So I'm just turning off 7 of the layers, and you can see here where we have some of our differential interfaces. Now you can see we have one grouping here, we have another grouping right here. Now, folks who are familiar with combination series parallel type interfaces where you have a source synchronous clock will know that what you're looking at right here on screen is a CSI interface. You basically have one clock lane, you have a differential clock, and then you have up to 4 data lanes. And that's exactly what we have here. And then we have another one right here. So we're gonna take a look first at some of these vias and just extract what we could consider a characteristic impedance of some of these differential vias. So if I zoom in here and just select some of these, and then I hit our electrical rule check button here and hit run, you can see here that it immediately starts extracting the impedance for some of the sections of this interconnect. So here in this section where our traces are pretty close together, you can see that the impedance gets all the way down to about 86 ohms. And then here where they flare out, they get up back up to the target of 100 ohms. Now here, where we have the via transition coming out of the BGA package for the FPGA, you can see that the via transition is 100 ohms, or it's basically 97.89 ohms, so pretty close to 100 ohms. Here, on the other side of the interconnect, where we terminate at a couple of vias, you can see here that the via impedance is much smaller. It's down to 53.85 ohms. So we have a couple of different via situations that we can examine here. Now, part of the reason that we have this difference between the via impedance is because, first of all, the location of the stitching vias around the signal vias, as well as the size of the antipad. Here, the antipad in this region where the vias flare out and get to a much lower impedance is actually a different value than the antipad size here where we're routing out of the FPGA. You can also see some ground vias surrounding our signal vias coming out of the bottom side of the BGA. And so the presence of those ground vias also impacts the impedance of our differential vias that you can see here on screen. We can repeat this same very simple analysis for some of these other lines that are on the CSI interface. For example, if we just deselect this one and select the other one, hit run, you see we get some pretty similar results. So this is all pretty consistent for this escape routing. And then same thing over here at this other end where we're routing into our vias on this end, you can see here that the vias have a characteristic impedance of 47.55. So again, pretty small when we look at the impedance. Now, of course, this being a high bandwidth differential channel, what doesn't matter is just the impedance. What matters is actually the S parameters. So we want to look at the S parameters of the via, and then we want to look at the S parameters of the entire link. So because this video is all about the vias, we're just going to focus on the vias first, and then we'll see what the S parameters for some of these links look like. So what I'm gonna do now is extract models for these interconnects, and then we're gonna look at the vias in the Via Analyzer tool in Simbeor. So let's go ahead and do it right now. So now we've completed some quick analysis here inside of Simbeor, and we have some measurements that are displayed on each end of this interconnect. So you can see here we have some measurements up on this end, and then we have some measurements that are highlighted down here on this end. Now, let's take a look at first, for example, the return loss of this interconnect. So you can see here for our return loss that we have pretty good return loss all the way up to about 8 or 9 gigahertz. This looks like right about 8 gigahertz. So that's pretty good. That's exactly what we need for this type of differential interface. We don't need to have super low return loss all the way up to, you know, 20 or 30 gigahertz or anything like that, because this is just a CSI2 line. So this channel is going to be just fine when we look at it from the return loss perspective. Also, from the insertion loss perspective, you can see here that we have really low insertion loss up to high frequencies. Now, at some point, we do get a very strong dip in the insertion loss right around 28 gigahertz. I think this is indicative of a stub on these lines because these are through-hole vias. So once you get up to very high frequencies, you do get very strong high Q limiting, very strong loss due to those stubs. And that's exactly what you see here in this insertion loss result. So now let's take a look at the differential vias that are extracted from this interconnect. So here, if I open up the via analyzer, you can see here we have our first set of vias coming out of the bottom of the BGA. And so that's the via model that you're seeing here. This other via model is at the other end of the interconnect where we have the lower impedance vias. So you can see here we have two different sets of vias that we can analyze. So now what we can do with the via analyzer tool is we can move around the position of the stitching vias and change the size of the antipads. We can also add or remove some stitching vias, and we can really see what happens to the impedance and, if we want, the S parameters of these via structures. So let's analyze these via models in a bit more detail. Now you can see here we have the vias coming out of the BGA for escape routing. And if you look in the lower right, you can see an impedance graph showing what is the impedance coming from the top going down and coming from the bottom going up. Now you can see here in both cases that both of these sets of vias have very good impedance profile all the way out to above 15 gigahertz. So that's pretty good, and that's exactly what we would want for a CSI lane. Now remember, CSI lanes do not have data rates at 10 gigabits per second or anything like that. They're actually much lower. So because of that, we don't necessarily require the channel to have, let's say, 15 or 20 gigahertz of bandwidth at 100 ohms impedance. However, this via does provide that much bandwidth at 100 ohms impedance. So that's good. That means we could use this via structure in a number of different interfaces. Now let's get back to the central point of this question. what would happen if we were to, let's say, remove a stitching via or maybe add a stitching via? Well, we have a stitching via right here that we can remove, just as an example. Let's go ahead and remove that stitching via. Now you see here that it looked like there wasn't really any effect on the impedance. However, there was an effect on the localization. You see that the localization limit moved here to the left to almost about 20 gigahertz. So that illustrates something important about the presence of those vias. The vias in this case are not so important for determining the impedance because we already have an antipad very close to the signal vias. But by removing one of those vias, you saw that the green limit here, or this green vertical line, moved to the left. It moved to lower frequencies. So that means the localization limit went to lower frequencies. So what this localization limit means is that anything below this green line has a very strong confinement around the signal vias, okay? It stays localized around the vias, okay? So all the signal power at frequencies below approximately 20 gigahertz will stay localized around the signal vias. But anything above 20 gigahertz will tend to radiate and get lost around the vias. So that's what this localization limit means. So that's one reason that you would want to keep more vias around your differential lines or around your single-ended lines. It will extend the localization frequency out to a higher value and help you confine more of that power around those signal vias. Now let's look at the other via model that was extracted from this interconnect. Now this is at the other end of the interconnect, and you can see here in these results that the impedance starts to dip and look capacitive as you get to higher and higher frequencies, and then eventually it starts to go back up and look inductive again. Now, because we have multiple vias around this structure, you can see what happens with the localization frequency. The localization frequency is at about 33 gigahertz, so that's pretty high. Now, these particular vias, although they start to dip in their impedance above about 5 gigahertz, they're still providing enough bandwidth at 100 ohms differential in order for this channel to be compliant with the CSI standard. So they're going to have a high chance of allowing enough of the signal power to then get into the transmission line and then get down to the receiver. So that's exactly what we want for this type of interface. Now again, what would happen if we remove one of these vias? Well, let's go ahead and remove, for example, via 3 and see what happens. So if we remove via 3, we actually don't really see any effect. It's a little bit farther away from these vias, so it doesn't have much effect on the localization. But let's go ahead and remove via 2. Now you see if I remove via 2, again, we had this jump from the localization frequency. It started at 33 gigahertz, and now it's down here at about 20 gigahertz. So again, we have a big reduction in the localization frequency, and that's going to allow this interconnect to start radiating above 20 gigahertz. So again, this is exactly why we might want to keep some of those vias on these differential lines. They help confine the signal power around those vias rather than allowing it to be lost at high frequencies. Now, the viewer question also asked, what would happen if we have a single-ended via? Well, what we can do is we can actually create a single-ended via that corresponds to our stack up, and then we can start adding some stitching vias around it just to see what happens at different frequencies. So here you can see I've created a single-ended via, and you can see it automatically populates with 4 stitching vias. Now I need to modify some of the default settings on the pad stacks. Like for example, here I need to change the pad size. So we're gonna change this to 20 mils. We also need to change, for example, the antipad size. Here we're gonna change it to, for example, 25 mils. Now we also need to change some of the layer settings. In order to change the layer settings, we can just go over here to the via barrel tab, and then we'll go ahead and set, for example, plane on layer 2, which is of course a ground plane. And then we also have plane on layer 7, also a ground plane. And then you can start to see the shape of our impedance curve start to form. We can also see what happens if we change, for example, which layer are we starting on and which layer are we ending on. So by default, this is of course a through-hole via, but let's say instead of routing from the top layer to the bottom layer, we route from the top layer to, for example, signal 3. Well, on layer 3, you can see that the impedance difference or the impedance profile is much different from the case where we're routing from the top layer to the bottom layer. So now let's see what happens if we were to start to add or remove stitching vias from this structure, and let's see what happens to the impedance. So first things first, let's say we go from 4 vias to 6 vias. Well, if I just start adding vias, you'll see here that the impedance curve does move just a little bit, but it doesn't move by a very large amount. And that's again for the same reason as the differential pair. Here, we have the antipad very close to the signal via, and that causes it to have the dominant influence on the via's impedance. We can also see this when we add a sixth stitching via. You can see here that the impedance dips just a little bit, but of course, not enough to make a huge difference from the case with only four stitching vias. But now let's say, for example, we increase the size of our antipad opening. Let's say we increase it to 40 mils. So now the antipad opening spans around our stitching vias. This is a little bit of an unrealistic case, but you kind of get the idea here. What happens when we make that antipad sufficiently large? Well, when we start to make that antipad sufficiently large, now adding a stitching via has a bigger impact on the change in the impedance than in the previous case. So the moral of the story here is that it's not just the number of stitching vias, it's also the size of the antipad in any plane layers where this via is passing through. If you start to make that antipad really small, the number of stitching vias has less of an effect on the impedance of the via, but you can see that it still has a major effect on the localization of the electromagnetic energy around that signal via, just as was the case with the differential pairs. So I hope this sufficiently answers the question of what happens when you start to add or remove stitching vias around a signal via in high-speed design. You have to look at the impedance curve as well as the localization of electromagnetic energy around the signal via. Thanks for asking this great question. And of course, if any of you, the viewers, have good questions and you want to see them in a video, just let me know in the comment section. Of course, if you leave a great comment on one of my videos on the Altium Academy channel, it just might make it into one of these videos. Make sure to hit that subscribe button on your screen. Make sure to subscribe to Altium Academy, and we'll see you next time. Thanks, everybody.